Good afternoon. I'm Grove resident Dean Thompson. Today our program is a conversation with Dr. Lisa Hansen, 30 years of Air Force chaplaincy followed by urban ministry at Pasadena Presbyterian Church. A highly decorated Air Force specialist, Colonel Hansen was born in Los Angeles. She was raised here in Woodland Hills. She attended Princeton Seminary under the care of Bel Air Presbyterian Church. Please bow in prayer with me. Lord Christ, at times we are like strangers on this earth, taken aback by all the violence, the harsh oppositions. Like a gentle breeze, you breathe upon us the spirit of peace. Transfigure the deserts of our doubts, and so prepare us to be bearers of reconciliation wherever you place us, until the day when a hope of peace dawns on our world. Amen. Our scripture is from the book of Romans, chapter 8.
Hey, Dean, could you give me about one more minute to finish it?
We're waiting for the scripture to be printed on your screen.
I know so many of these people. I see so many names and so many people I know.
Good. Jonas, I can read it anyway, if you like. I mean, Andrew.
Go ahead.
Okay, I'm going to read it. This is from Romans chapter 8, scripture chosen by Colonel Hansen. Very familiar. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Well, Dr. Hansen, one of the things that has been very clear to me is that you carry many titles which describe your interesting personhood. Your titles include chaplain, reverend, doctor, colonel, mother, and they indicate a fascinating personal journey. Unpack what all those titles mean to you.
Oh, my goodness. It was fascinating listening to you introduce me as Dr. Hansen. It's one of the titles I go by the least. To me, the titles are just kind of a way station of various places I've stopped in my life and things that I've done. So the doctor titles based on education and my love for education and my continuing pursuit of learning and engaging in the learning process. The Air Force title, Colonel, which was less preferred than chaplain, just kind of was an indicator of my rank and who I am and what I did and where I was in the military. Reverend, the indicator of my chosen vocation or the vocation God chose for me. Pastor, the preferred one for me. So pastor and chaplain preferred because they are more of a intimate, personal relationship with people. And then of course my favorite, which is mom, which is the one that my son uses the most. And then just the name given, the name that my parents gave me when they adopted me, is also the one I like a lot, the Lisa, which was the name I was baptized with. So yeah, they mean various places in my life and various places I've stopped and various places I continue to go and how I connect and interact with people.
I mentioned that Dr. Colonel Chaplain Hansen is my pastor, and that's a dear privilege. You told me that Air Force taught you team. Air Force taught you team and collaborative leadership. Unpack that for us.
Yeah, when I first started in ministry, I was an associate pastor at a very large church. And although we had a team, we didn't necessarily work as a team. I had Christian education and I oversaw everything related to Christian education. The senior pastor was the preaching pastor. We had a youth minister. And then we had a visitation pastor. And we worked together, but not as a team. When I joined the Air Force, everything is geared there towards teamwork and the idea that you cannot get a mission done without your team members. And that's true throughout all levels of the military. A pilot has a wingman, but the pilot cannot get in the air without the mechanics and without the people who are working on the ground at the airfield. And so in the chaplaincy as well, we worked as a team. We had the enlisted people who helped us as the team members. We worked as a team of very disparate people, usually a Roman Catholic priest, somebody from a conservative denomination, Protestant denomination. I got to represent the more high church because we baptized infants. So I was part of a team that did that always had an infant or a baby baptizer on staff. And then our civilian counterparts working, the secretarial helpers and civilians who worked with us. And the idea was that we would work together and work towards completing the mission and supporting the mission. And it was in teamwork and working together that we got so much done. If we'd worked solely on our own, building our own little parish or pastorate, we would never get things done for the whole mission. So it really was grounded to me, the concept of team, the ability to work as a team, because you multiply what you can do in supporting one another.
Did you have experiences of different denominations being hesitant or reluctant to collaborate in terms of team?
Yeah, well, particularly if there were women on the team. So some of the more conservative Protestant denominations had more difficulty working, I would say working with a woman than they had difficulty working with Roman Catholic, although they would often have issues with Roman Catholic priest or with a rabbi or an imam. So for them, I would say smaller or more conservative Protestant denominations that look at a church being the sole group. So independent churches, they had a hard time with teamwork, and we would have to work really hard with them to get to the point where they would want to be part of the team, that they would want to work with the team, that they would see the value in working as part of the team. Most of those, if they couldn't work with a team, didn't stay in the military beyond 3 to 5 years. They just found it too hard.
So there were some who were reluctant to follow female leadership.
Many, yes. Yes. Mm-hmm. And we would have to remind them that they joined the military and the military has rules. And one of the rules is it doesn't matter the gender of the person that leads you.
And that's ongoing, that reluctance among some.
Yes, it is. Yeah.
What would you say the percentages of reluctance to follow female leadership in the military? What would those percentages look like? Just a guesstimate.
Well, across the board, I would say for the whole military, it would be about 20, maybe 20-30%. In the chaplain corps, it was much higher because we had a very high percentage of conservative evangelical, non-denominational or Baptist people who are religiously opposed to women in leadership. Mm-hmm. So I'd say that is about 70% found it difficult to follow a woman as a leader.
All right. That's fascinating. You also have mentioned to me that your chaplaincy taught you spiritual sensitivity and opened your eyes to the world in ways that you did not suspect. What was that experience like for you, Pastor Lisa?
Well, growing up I grew up in a Reformed church, an RCA, a Reformed Church in America congregation, and then joined Bel Air Presbyterian while I was in college at UCLA. But in the Reformed way of doing things, it's always very staid and very reserved. And I was just so terrified as a young adult and young person of the elders. The elders were very terrifying to me, a group of men making decisions for the church. And it was men when I was growing up. And to get to the military and find people who were very, very different, culturally very different, religiously very different, and to be aware of their background, to understand that the reasoning for their looking towards a believer's baptism or their reasoning for their reliance on the Holy Spirit. So you typically work with somebody who's from a charismatic background. And what it did for me in dialogue with people from these various viewpoints of Christianity or even Judaism and Islam, was it gave me a sense of the vastness of our relationship with God and how people come to God in different ways and experience God in different ways. And in particular, when I was deployed once, I had a lay leader who was charismatic. And we would discuss his experience of the Holy Spirit and what that meant to him and how that impacted his relationship with God, which really helped me deepen my relationship with the Holy Spirit, because Presbyterians and Reformed folk aren't particularly that outgoing. There's in a lot of places, you're not going to see a lot of hand raising. You're certainly not going to see anybody dancing in the aisles or being slain by the Spirit. And that also helped me when I was a leader in the chaplaincy and asked to preach at the Catholic Mass or preach at one of the charismatic services and not get too thrown off by that. I would say the first time I preached at one of our African-American worship services, I was not prepared for people to speak back to me during the sermon. So that was really eye-opening to me, but I miss it from time to time. So those of you from Pasadena, if you want to shout out an amen from time to time, it's okay.
The Grove is inclined to shout out and do call and response. We're very good.
That was new to me, and it really helped me see some things differently, and just the whole concept of we all approach God differently, and how God is open to that and accepting of that, and it just deepens our relationship with God to see it in these different ways. So that was very helpful. And working with rabbis to understand the roots of Judaism and what that means, and how to be sensitive to the needs of our Jewish personnel. And I had an imam I worked with who was really remarkable in just understanding where they come from in relationship to the Hebrew scriptures and to the, and they read the New Testament as well. So what their understanding of that is, and how that is different, and how their spirituality is so strong, and what Ramadan means to them. So all of these things I've learned, different aspects of spirituality, how to interact with God differently, how to be aware of the conservative or the liberal points of view that people have, and how to find the middle ground in all of that, because all of it's related to God and God's love for us.
I've been touched personally by how much I'm energized in African-American congregations by call and response. They just don't want you to fail. They want you to bring it home. And if you're not bringing it home, they'll get on the bases with you and help you bring it home.
Exactly. And then it's a more free flow conversation. Well, not a conversation, but there is that free flow. And you're definitely not going to preach a 12-minute sermon. It's going to go for a while. And you need to be prepared to say it and say it again and say it three or four more times in different ways. But it's an openness to the spirit, because what I found in that, right now I'm doing a written sermon, is in that situation, I would not go in with a written sermon. I would just go in being open to where the spirit would call and just kind of go with it.
I'm also fed by Judaism's, as I speak in with Jewish congregations, I'm fed by their love of argument and debate, and how natural debate and argument are for Jews, and they've helped me to grow in terms of appreciating argument.
Very much so. And that takes people aback. When I was teaching at the chaplain school, we had some people who were really upset by the fact that the rabbi was correcting them on some of their interpretations of Jesus. It was that whole sense of argument. I also, from my Jewish friends, the sense of hospitality, the openness of their homes and hospitality, is Islamic friends as well, during Ramadan, being invited to break the fast or invited to Sabbath meals, strong sense of hospitality.
Yeah, the hospitality factor in the African-American tradition has deeply influenced my life. I'm Pharaoh when I when I visit their congregation, and they always treat me like I'm Jesus. I mean, it's just overpowering.
It is remarkable.
Yep, a miraculous experience. Pastor Lisa, in your career in military, you've dealt a lot with PTSD, and we certainly have been instructed that as military people return from service, that PTSD is a great factor. You mentioned to me earlier that PTSD greatly involves dealing with moral injury. Mm-hmm. Unpack that interpretation of post-traumatic stress syndrome for us, please.
Yeah, a lot of the research done in moral injury is related to the sense that human beings aren't meant to murder other human beings. And regardless of what we like to think about the military, the primary role of the military is to break things and kill people. And it really impacts the soul deeply when you do that. The destroying things of things or of killing people. And it doesn't have to be direct. When I was at the beginning of the latest Gulf War, so when after 9/11, when we invaded Iraq, I was with a group of people that were bombers. They were bombing Iraq, and the pilots did not have that much of an issue with going and doing their mission and dropping the bombs. The bomb builders had all sorts of problems with the morality of building an item that would destroy buildings and kill people. And we spent a lot of time dealing with their moral injury related to that, what it meant to be involved in the chain of hurting people. And drone operators have a huge problem with this as well, because of that sense of being distant from the action and being involved in it. So they don't feel the threat, they just do the act. And I think that might be some of that moral injury as well. But it impacts the soul in a great way, because God really didn't create for us to hurt or harm one another. God created it for us to love one another, to love God. And so in doing that, it breaks people apart in various ways. And the chaplains work hand in hand with the social workers and the mental health professionals in helping to heal the woundedness that people carry. In all of that, it scars you forever to be part of that, but at least we can help towards the healing of that. So there's a lot of work in that area, and it requires a lot of mindfulness and meditation and prayer and soul searching to get over.
I was taken aback when you mentioned to me earlier that the military is a trauma-inducing job. Mm-hmm. I'm also taken aback and deeply concerned about the ongoing amount of suicide in the military, both while people are serving and after leaving the service and returning to their home environment. Did you deal a lot with suicide?
Yes, we did. So chaplains are involved in part of the teams that that provide support and aid to all of military members. And we review the suicide information monthly. We work with very closely with all the helping agencies to look at how do we prevent and how do we intervene and what do we need to do to deal with the statistics. And that was because Congress had gotten so involved and concerned about it. The reality is that the suicide numbers, the percentage of suicides attempted and completed in the military is actually slightly less than that of the United States in general. So it's not necessarily higher. There's a lot more resources put at preventing and intervening and helping with that. And I taught some of those courses on suicide intervention and suicide support, and then had to deal with the aftermath of suicides that were completed or counsel people who had been suicidal and dealing with things. For the most part, what we found is if you can intervene in such a way that you prevent somebody from completing the suicide, they typically do not attempt again. They just get themselves locked into a position. But the military was really good about going into what are the financial causes, what are the spiritual causes, what are the traumatizing effects of being in the military causes, and trying to mitigate those. And I wish that we did that in society a little bit better and a little bit more. But suicide still hangs over us in a lot of different ways, and it hurts a great deal. I think for me, one of the having seen it firsthand and having to deal with it, it affected our people so deeply. So those who were left behind, you wish that the person had heard what they had to say before they completed the suicide, because they would be aware of how much they were loved. I think that was the missing key in all of it. But one suicide in particular, in the memorial service, the mother spoke and about how angry she was at her son for taking his life. And one of the commanders went to his commander. So a full bird colonel went to his commander and said, I am feeling the same way. And we were able to get him help immediately. So, and he was in security forces. So he was dealing with a lot of stress and strain. That's where most of our young people who committed suicide came out of the security forces career field. A lot of that is working 12-hour shifts, four days a week, 2 days off. I mean, their shifts were just horrible, and the strain was difficult for them.
Doctor, you in 30 years went on a tremendous amount of special missions, Rwanda, Mozambique, Ukraine, NATO, the Arctic. Unpack some of your special missions and how they impacted you and helped you to grow as a person.
Yeah, it's hard to answer. I know people have asked me on specific ones. I spent a lot of time in Africa. So a lot of my missions were in Africa, which is unusual. Most people went on their missions in the Middle East. I would say the one that impacted me probably the most was going to Rwanda. And that was when we were doing air support to the refugees who had left Rwanda and gone into the Republic of Congo, which was at that point in time Zaire. And it was immediately after the genocide. So there was still very clear signs of the genocide going on, and they were burning bodies as a way of preventing disease, which has been kind of embedded and it's a smell that's really hard to get out of your body and your senses. So it was what I got out of that was the horror of genocide and what that means. And so when I went to National War College and was working on strategies, I really was drawn to what went wrong with the world's strategy in preventing what happened in Rwanda. And we had many options and opportunities to prevent the genocide, and we failed as a world to help those people. And it was caused by colonization and the sense of pitting people against other people. And it was hard to return to the aftermath of Rwanda. It's always hard to see that. Beautiful, beautiful country, beautiful people. And just to see how they devastated one another. So for me, it's that whole sense of why do we continue to try as a world to eradicate people or to conquer or to destroy people? And then I did the work on NATO. So when I did work on NATO, we were looking at it's developing a strategy for adding Sweden into NATO. Little did we know that Putin had figured out how to do that. But Sweden was not particularly inclined towards NATO. So we were just kind of looking at what would involve them. And their biggest concern was Russia.
And I'm fascinated that you've been to Ukraine.
I haven't been to, not Ukraine. Yeah, no, we were just looking at the Ukraine issue. I was in Brussels, and where NATO's headquartered, and then in Sweden and France.
When you experienced such horror in a place like Rwanda, how did you personally hold up, maintain, not decompose in the face of such horror? Where do you get your strength? What enables you to abide and maintain in very traumatic places like that?
For me, it's prayer and the reliance on God. That's why I selected the one scripture that really holds me up in a lot of difficult times. That sense of no matter what goes on in this world, no matter what you see, what impacts you, there is nothing in this world that can separate you from God's love. And just being able to pray, music does that for me as well. Very much drawn to music. And that is one of the reasons I love Pasadena Presbyterian Church so much, is the fine music that we have on a Sunday. So music and prayer and scripture and talking to people, being with people, and being able to just experience things with them and talk that through and find God in whatever wherever we can find God in the beauty of this earth. Walking, I do a lot of walking and enjoying nature. In fact, my phone is probably filled with hundreds of pictures of flowers and very few pictures of people, which is very strange, but mostly because I love nature so much.
You need to come to our campus and photograph our roses.
There you go.
Exquisite. And you are a musician, right?
Yeah, yes. I I grew up playing piano and went into competitions and realized I didn't like to compete with the piano. I just loved to play it, and then singing. So I sang in the chamber choir at Princeton, and I've always sung in choirs. And I'm a not a very good bell ringer, but I like to ring the bells. So bell ringing is good. And then I raised a musician. So my son is a trumpet player and a music major at Pasadena City College.
Wonderful. Yeah. Well, as you think about your 30 years of chaplaincy, how has that experience impacted your PPC ministry? How has that fed into your ministry as an urban pastor?
There are days I wonder if I have to be very, very careful to not be the colonel. So it's a balancing act for me. It's learning to let people lead and learning to encourage them in their own leadership. So it's impacted me because it's allowed me to find people and meet people where they're at. It's allowed me to be very introspective about what I do and how I do and how I interact with people, and very sensitive to the needs of other people. So I got that out of the Air Force. And my sense in being in urban ministry and then coming into urban ministry in the midst of a pandemic, I'm grateful for being in the Air Force, because in the Air Force is always taught people and is built on thinking outside the box and not taking a barrier as a solid barrier, but finding a different way to manage it and do and be, and in order to get things done. So I probably was well prepared for this, but it's something I need to grow into and learn more about. And I'm always in dialogue with people and reaching out to people and learning from the amazing people at this church and learning more and more about what the needs are in an urban setting.
So amazed me that you began parish ministry at the beginning of this pandemic. What an incredible challenge.
Yeah, I think I couldn't have picked a worse time, but it was God who picked the time. And it was good and bad. It was bad because I wanted to go into a church and really kind of be with people and learn from people and meet people and get excited about people. And you couldn't do that except on Zoom. And the good about the Zoom was I learned people's faces and names because I was interacting, that, you know, it's like a name tag. You're wearing your name tag all the time on Zoom. So that helped me a great deal. And I'm not particularly good at names. PPC in a lot of ways is like my 10th church, all of these various chapels, and people start looking the same, or you think, oh yeah, I know that person. People act the same, I just get them all mixed up. I get all my people all mixed up. So it was helpful that way, but hard because and some people have learned this. I'm a rule follower. That's what the military teaches you. You follow the rules. The rules are good. And there are a lot of people who had a hard time with the rules during COVID. So to kind of work with people on, there are rules, and then there are times we can kind of fudge around the rules, but we have to follow. The reason we follow the rules is to keep everybody safe, is to make sure people are cared for and safe and loved and know God's love. it's a challenge, but there have been worse challenges I've had to deal with.
I'm fascinated by one aspect of, as I imagine, being a colonel. Your job is to be in charge as a colonel. How do you do with delegation? Are you any good at it?
Probably terrible at it. Well, I mean, yes and no. It's been learning how to defer. And I'm so grateful for a great clerks of session and great elders to work with who remind me that it's their job. And so learning to defer to that, because I was the person who had to make the decisions, the buck stops here person. That was my job as a colonel. So when I was working in the Pentagon, it would be, I'd have to make a decision that affected all of the chaplains. But I had to make that decision. It was a decision that fell on my desk. And so I took all of the advice and made the decision. In a church, it's the session and the leaders that make the decisions. And it's learning how to hand that back and say, you tell me, you give me the guidance. And I think in a lot of ways, the leadership that I learned and being part of a team member has helped me do that. But there have been bumps and fits just let me do it. I can do it. This is easy. I'll just get rid of this. It's off my desk. Instead of saying, let's send it back to the deliberative body. Let's let the body work with this, and let's let the church kind of deal with this issue and figure out the best way forward. And that is, I'm grateful for my years at USC because that's what I've learned from them, is in any leadership and any change movement, you need the people to really, you need the diversity of the team to really come up with the best solution.
It's interesting to think about where you're in a position where you are in command, and then in Presbyterian polity, the leadership is, I mean, it's spread out. It's really spread out, and we, in Presbyterian polity, we believe that by and large and generally speaking, groups make more trustworthy decisions than individuals. So that's quite a different setup as you move from military into it's been said that Presbyterianism is arguably the most openly democratic system that there is. It's very, very democratic. Ronald Niebuhr said that kind of democracy is the best of bad systems. I mean, it's messy and takes forever. That's different from the world you came here from.
It is and it isn't. And I think part of that is because in the Air Force, we've relied on the enlisted person to give their feedback and input. And I remember when we started doing joint work with the Army, when we sent some of our enlisted chaplain assistants to work with Army people, they would get in trouble because they would ask their chaplain, why do you want me to do that? In the Army, you don't ask why, you just do. In the Air Force, we've trained people to ask why? And then we ask for their input. So you do want the mechanic to say to the pilot, this is the limitation, or I have a better way of doing that. So there is and there isn't, but the military structure in and of itself does say, you know, the final decision is made by that higher ranking person. And I do like the collaborative style. I do like that sense of taking time to make a good decision, because a church is not about making a fast decision. In the military, we have to make fast decisions. You know, it's life or death. The decision has to be made quickly, and it has to be made with assurance. And the person in the highest rank takes all the consequences for that. But in the church, it's all about, you know, it's slow deliberative, because it's about caring and sharing and loving. And so you don't want to make a fast decision. You want to make the right decision. You want to do the thing that shows God's love in the best way.
You're not going to brag on yourself, but you just earned a doctorate, right?
I did, yes.
You've got that recently from USC?
I did, yeah. It was hard.
What's the doctorate in, Dr. Hansen?
This one's in, it's an educational doctorate. It's in the EDD, and I earned it in organizational change and leadership at USC in their School of Education. Yeah.
Congratulations to you. I have a question from the chat from my colleague, Lynn Cheney. She says, "You are amazing. How did you keep your sanity, soul, sense of self in the midst of so much opposition to your gender amongst chaplain colleagues? What was your posture behavior toward those chaplains? What was your posture behavior toward those chaplains who did not affirm your calling, who didn't respect your calling?"
I strive to try to meet people with love and find where there's some commonality. So I was able to do it by not being forceful, but by sitting down and sharing a meal, sharing a prayer, sharing a concern. And I found that to be better common ground than to just say, you need to accept this, or you need to respect me, but to kind of earn the respect of people. And that had always been easier. There's some people that will never change and they will have a hard time with it. But I learned over the years that if you sit down and you pray with people, if you sit down and you eat with people, and these are things that Jesus did, if you talk and converse with people with love and respect, that they begin to love and respect you. That's pretty much how I managed. And then I just realized that some people just will never change, and God loves them anyway. So that I just handed them off to God.
That's a good handoff. I've got Cynthia White, who wants to ask you a question.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Would you speak to the continuing problem of sexual harassment in the military? Where are we with this, in your view?
We're better than we were. So I can tell you that I was a victim of sexual assault. And so my level of PTSD in the military is from sexual assault, from a civilian chaplain leader, supervisor. When I was assaulted, I could not report. It was very clearly stated to women that if you reported, your career would be over. But they've changed the reporting process. They have provided confidential medical care, mental health care, they're changing the chain of command and getting the chain of command out of that. So things are changing. It seems draconian and slow, but things are changing for the better. So yeah, it is rampant because it's a male-dominated field. So they're working on it, and I would say some of our younger people, our younger people in the military, are very sensitive and very supportive, and working towards ending sexual harassment and sexual assault. And I would also add to that, that's not solely for women in the military. It's an issue for women in ministry. It's an issue for women who are in any field that was primarily a male-oriented field. So when I did my research on my doctorate on women in ministry, and I was looking at job retention, and one of the things that came up that was clearly experienced by all of the people I interviewed was that women were assaulted or harassed by other clergy or by their parishioners. So it's not just in the military. Wow.
Other questions from our, we've got Bill Craig right here.
Yeah. Lisa, we had a friend that we've kept in touch with. She was an intern at our church many, many years ago and became an Air Force chaplain. Her name is Terry Gast. And she does work now with veterans in suicide prevention. Do you keep in touch with any of the people that you've been associated with in chaplaincy?
Oh my goodness, yes. I do. Many of them on a regular basis, we kind of touch base on things, and some people still reach out to me. I know Terry, not really well, but I know her. I knew when she was active duty. So yeah, I keep in touch with you.
Thank you. Amazing, wonderful presentation. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Other questions, Andrew? Can you help me look to see if there are other people who want to speak out? Just speak out and ask a question if you like.
So it looks like there is a there's actually a comment here from Laura Monteros, and it says, Lisa, I chuckled about the name / face confusion. I like to say the same 100 people go to every church. It's easy to mix them up.
Yeah, I would agree with you, Laura. It's probably the truest thing I've heard today.
And then there is another question here from Lynn. And it says, with apologies for the label, you seem to be a fairly progressive sort. How did you or do you separate your own political perspectives from the decisions of those who might be making military decisions with which you do not agree?
I am, as I would tell people, theologically conservative in that I'm a follower of Jesus, which makes me socially liberal. In the military, they advise you to not get too politically involved in anything anyway. So I've stayed fairly apolitical, and I come from a very conservative family. So I try not to get into political arguments with anybody about anything. When I look at political perspective, I look at what are we doing that exemplifies the love of God, and how do we do that as a nation politically? And I've spoken out about certain things, and I've been in marches, which you're allowed to do as long as you're not wearing the uniform. And I have stood my ground with some some policymakers. In fact, I stood my ground with the chief of chaplains a couple of times on issues that I felt were leaning too much towards conservative political point of view in a place where we didn't need to be political. So I don't mind stating what I believe, but I also always want to back it up with what is the perspective of a Christian? What is a perspective of somebody who would follow Jesus?
In terms of your biblical theological sense-making, as a preacher, I've appreciated the fact that that you haven't shied away from politics, but have interlaced your sermons with biblical theological sense-making and whatever happens in the world. And I've deeply appreciated that, Dr. Colonel Reverend.
Mom.
I've got Jackie Terpstra who wants to say something.
Yeah, hi, Lisa. Two quick questions that are kind of different. One, were you ever required to carry a weapon?
No. So the answer to that immediately is chaplains aren't allowed in the Air Force to carry a weapon. Now, I have to qualify that with, did I learn how to shoot a weapon? Yes. And only because I learned it while I was a chaplain candidate, and therefore not a chaplain. And I was at the Air Force Academy, and the students were going through weapons training. And so I went through weapons training. And pretty good shot, but I haven't picked up a gun since then. I'm really opposed to guns, and it was like all I could think of is if it came to a point in time where I had to give up the cross, which is the emblem of being in a chaplain, or save the life of an individual by picking up a weapon and knowing how to shoot and not kill somebody, I would pick up the weapon. So that's why I learned how to shoot.
Now, I don't remember being a good shot on your resume.
Now, it's in my medals. I have, okay. I have not in one that I wear, but I have a marksman medal, yeah.
Oh, that's great. My other question is, I know you've lived in many places while you were in the service. And I always wonder how that impacts children. You know, having to change schools, change towns, change friends. I know there's a camaraderie in the military, but they still have to leave friends behind.
Yeah, my son went to 7 different schools, and it was hard, but they learned how to make friends fast, so that's good, but it's hard on the families to move around so much. It's hard on the kids, and it's hard on people to do that. If that's his story, he probably could tell it to you better. You'll have to ask him.
We've got time for one more question or comment from our wonderful audience today. We've got one more opportunity going.
Dean, I see a couple things in the chat, and just Don talks about the orange candle, the orange ribbon on the candle on the communion table, which is for gun violence, and I will be speaking to that on Sunday, gun violence in this country, but the church is very, has taken a stance against gun violence. And then Betty, I think my son, as much as he dislikes not having a place he can call home, he has seen so much of the world, he appreciates that so much better than having a place that he can call home.
Lisa, Chaplain Colonel, Dr. Reverend, we are your debtors. This has been a wonderful conversation with you, and we're so grateful for the chance to get to know you better. Please come to our campus and walk around and take pictures of our our roses, and we'll be kind to you. And I want to remind folks that we're in for a real treat next Thursday. We will our convocation will feature Grove residents Angie and Bruce Armstrong and Glenn Jones. We're going to get to know them better, and that'll be a real treat for all of us. In the meantime, thank you, Dr. Hansen, and God bless us one and all.
Thank you.